Hello, my name is Will van der Aalst, and it's a great pleasure to present a paper that has recently been accepted. In this paper, I show that free choice nets with home clusters are loosened. This is very surprising because we do not require these free choice nets to be well formed. What I mean exactly by that and why it is surprising, I will try to explain in this talk. So as I mentioned, this talk is based on an accepted paper for Fundamenta Informatica. It will probably appear in the next couple of months. There's also a preprint available, and you can see the URL here. So this paper explores the relationship between home clusters and lucency. An important observation, because the relationship between home clusters and lucency has been investigated before, an important observation is that the main result holds without requiring the net to be well formed. Recall that the Petri net is well formed if it has at least a marking where the net is live and bounded. What I mean with all of these terms I will explain in a minute, but for the people that are familiar with free choice theory, know that in most of the papers and in most of the publications, there is the requirement that there is this well-formed property, which for example also implies that the PetriNet is strongly connected, ruling out many, let's say, practical process models that people would normally draw. The result is surprising. What is also surprising is that it is proven without building upon existing free choice theory. So all the proofs are very direct. And therefore, I believe that the results of this paper will open up new research lines that are using these new insights that do not require all the machinery of well-formed free choice nets. So I've been using various terms, and I will just try to refresh your knowledge of, let's say, basic PetriNet theory. I will not explain that in detail, but I will introduce, let's say, some of the standard concepts. So PetriNet is composed of places and transitions. In the places, there can be tokens, and the marking is a distribution over tokens over the various places. So here we are in the marking with one token in P1. We want to reach the final marking with one token in P8, and in between we visit all kinds of other markings. Transitions can be enabled, and they are enabled if on each of the input places there is at least a token. If that is the case, a transition is enabled, it can fire or occur, and that means that we take one token of all of the input places and produce one token for all of the output places. Nothing new. So if transition T1 fires because it is enabled, it will consume one token and produce three tokens, a token for P2, P3 and P4. If we are in this situation where there's a token in P2, P3 and P4, in principle, let's say four transitions are enabled, T2, T4, T5 and T6. Note that T5 and T6 represent a choice, so either T5 executes and takes the token or T6 executes and takes the token. And this is independent of the occurrence of T4 and T2. Imagine that T2 fires, T4 fires, and T5 fires. Then, at that point in time, T7 is enabled, not sooner, because T7 requires a token on each of the input places. Then T7 occurs and produces a token on the output place. Note that with T3 we can loop back. So a possible execution would be T1, T2, T4, T5, T3, T2, T3, T2, T7, leading from the marking with the token in P1 to marking with just the token in P8. So this was refreshing your basic PetriNet knowledge. Then PetriNets have different properties. And these properties are often defined just for well-formed nets, and well-formed nets are strongly connected. So from any node, there is a directed path to any other node. So for these well-formed nets, there are standard properties like boundedness, safeness, deadlock freeness, and liveness. Boundedness, but by the way, these properties also hold, are also defined if the net is not well-formed. However, a net is well-formed if and only if it has a marking for which the net is live and bounded. So I need to explain what liveness is and what boundedness is. So boundedness means that starting from some initial marking, the number of tokens on a particular place is limited. It cannot grow beyond a certain bound. If that holds for every place, then we say that the net is bounded. So if the bound is k, we say it is k-bounded. And k-bounded means that no place can have more than k tokens, no matter what path we take through the POSIX model. Safeness is a special kind of boundedness. It means that this k is equal to 1, so a place can never have 2 tokens. So 1 is the maximal number of tokens per place. A net is in a deadlock if no transition can fire. So a deadlock is a reachable marking in which nothing can happen anymore. Then we have the notion of liveness. That's the most complex notion. Liveness, so a transition is live if no matter what we do, no matter what path we follow, it is always possible to fire this transition again and again and again. In other words, a transition can never become disabled, no matter what path we take. So it may take a few steps before we enable it again, but it should always be possible. So if in a net all transitions are live, the net is called live. When we have a workflow net, like on the previous slide, then we have something with a clear start and end. Many models have this property. To look at notions like well-formedness, we typically short-circuit the net. Why is this relevant? If we look at this model, then it is, for example, clear that if there is a token in P8, we are in a deadlock. Nothing can happen anymore. So the net is not deadlock-free, and it is not live. This net, what we look at now, is deadlock-free and is also live. So typically, we need to use tricks like short-circuiting, etc., etc., to create a net that is strongly connected and well-formed. A subclass of Petri nets are the so-called free choice nets, and an important property there is the so-called cluster property. So what is a cluster? A cluster is a set of a minimal set of places and transitions in such a way that for every place we have all the output transitions, and for every transition in the set, we have all the input places. So here, labeled in the different colors, are the different clusters. So let me switch out my pointer. So we have one cluster here composed of P1 and T1, one cluster composed of P2 and T2, one composed of P3 and P4. Then here we have a cluster with true transitions and one place. There is the gray one, composed of P8 and this short-circuiting transition. And we have a cluster that is indicated here in red. So why is this a cluster? Because if we look at P5, all the output transitions should be in there. If we look at T7, all the input places should be there. So this is one cluster. So this Petri net is not free choice. So what is the free choice property? And you can define this in different ways. The way that I prefer it, if a place has two outgoing transitions, two output transitions, then these output transitions should have exactly the same set of input places. And if you look at this example, P5 has two output transitions, but these transitions do not have the same input set, the same set of input places. So T3 has as input set P5, T7 has as input set P5, P6, and P7. So this is not free choice. And nets that are not free choice, they have constructs where choice, so P5 represents a choice, and synchronization are somehow mixed. Yeah, so here we are synchronizing with T7, but at the same time there is a choice, and that choice is not free, it is not symmetric. If I add, let's say, another transition T3, let's say T3A and T3B, where T3A means that we go back, the other one means that we end, now the net is free choice. And so now the original red cluster is split into two clusters. So this PetriNet is free choice, and it satisfies, let's say, the free choice property. So we will focus on free choice nets. We will also have a syntactical limitation. So we will not require that the net is short-circuited, like this one. It does not need to be strongly connected. However, we have the requirement to avoid, let's say, foolish nets. We have the requirement that every transition should have at least one input arc and one output arc. Yeah, so again, proper means every transition has at least one input and at least one output. So for the collection of well-formed free choice nets, there are many, many strong theoretical results. And so here are some pointers to papers. Highly recommended is the book on free choice PetriNets by Jörg Dezel and Javier Esparza. That's the standard reference if you're interested in knowing more about free choice nets. And there you will see beautiful results like the coverability theorems. So every free choice, well-formed free choice net is covered by P components and T components. There are theorems related to ciphers and traps. I will not explain what that is. There is the rank theorem using the marking equation. And there is a complete set of reduction rules, and these reduction rules preserve well-formedness both in the reduction sense and in the synthesis sense. So there are these beautiful results. And again, I would highly recommend this book. But the limitation of all of these results is that they always assume that the free choice net is well formed. All these theorems are kind of focusing on that or assuming that. But we would also like to deal with PetriNets that look like this. So if you look at the first one, it looks a bit complicated. But what you can see is that this is a free choice net. So when transitions are competing for a token, they have identical input sets. But it is, for example, not strongly connected. And because it's not strongly connected, it cannot be well-formed. Because that's any well-formed free choice net is strongly connected by definition. And we, for example, see that P1 and P2 have no input arcs, so that is not possible. This is a simpler example. You can see that it's completely trivial. It is free choice, but it is not well-formed. And so we always end up in a deadlock. So if there is a token in P4, there's nothing else that we can do. So in the other example, we will always end up in the marking with P7 and P8. And in that marking, we can only fire T8, but we cannot go back. So the moment that we reach the marking with the token in P7 and P8, T1, T2, until T7 are all dead. They can never happen again. So these are not well formed, but in many application domains, for example, when we look at modeling workflows in the field of process mining, we often want to have models like this, that have, for example, a start and an end. And they don't need to have this regular structured behavior where anything can be repeated again and again. So let's now look at the property that we would like to derive and where we are interested in what are the requirements that it holds. So I talked earlier about liveness, and I don't want to use liveness. I would like to use a weaker property, and that is it is not exactly weaker, but from an application perspective, a more reasonable requirement. And that requirement is that if there are two different markings that are reachable, they cannot enable exactly the same set of transitions. So if we have two markings and the set of transitions enabled in these two markings, then these two markings should be the same. So this is an example of a net that has that property. It is loosened. So there are four possible states, and in every possible state, the set of enabled transitions is different. So if there is a token in P1, T1 and T2 are enabled. If there is a token in P2, T3 is enabled. If there is a token in P3, P4 and P5 are enabled. If there is a token in P4, no transition is enabled. So for each of the reachable markings, we have a unique characterization in terms of the set of enabled transitions. This is an example of a net that is not loosened. It's also not free choice. And why is it not loosened? If we fire T1, then there is a token in P2 and P5, and then only T3 is enabled. If we fire T2, then there is a token in P2 and P6, so a different marking, but again, just T3 is enabled. In other words, we have this red reachable marking after firing T1, and we have the blue reachable marking after firing T2. And both markings, the red one and the blue one, both have the same set of enabled transitions, namely only transition 3. So this was an example of a net that is not loosened, but the net that I just showed is also not free choice. This is an example of a net that is free choice. It's a bit involved, so it takes some time to play the token game and to fully understand this model. What you can see, it is free choice. But if we look at the set of reachable markings, we find out that we have the marking with the token in P3, P5 and P7. But we can also reach the marking with the token in P3, P7 and P8. Note that in both the red and the blue marking, transitions T1 and T4 are enabled. In other words, it is invisible, based on the set of enabled markings, whether P5 or P8 is marked. Both are possible. So this is not loosened, and from an application perspective, this could be undesirable, because the state is somehow not observable. This was an example that was clearly a free choice net. Here I have an example that is, let's say, a marked graph, or a T-net it is sometimes called. So in this net, if you look at the places, every place has one input and one output. So by definition, it's free choice, but it's even stronger than that. If you look at this simple, super simple marked graph, we have two reachable markings that enable T1 and T4. So there is this marking. Let's say the initial marking, and there is this marking. So note that I can reach this marking by firing T1 and T2, and then I go from the red marking to the blue marking. And in both markings, T1 and T4 are enabled. So this is not loosened, and that's very, let's say, surprising that the net is well formed. The net is a marked graph, etc., etc., and we can still have this property. But we are interested in nets that are loosened, that do not have this property. So as a motivation, think, for example, of a workflow management system. And in the workflow management system, work is offered to people in so-called work lists. So in the work list, they can see what they need to do. At any point in time, if you know the state of the work list, you kind of know what the state of the system is. At least that is something that you could assume as something that would be desirable. Another example would be, we look at the system. The system has a user interface. And if we look at the user interface and we know exactly the state of the user interface, can we determine what the internal state is? That is what loosency assumes. If the system is not loosened, that means that the UI may show exactly the same thing in two different states. And the outside world cannot tell the difference. So that's a practical motivation for lucency. And I got this idea to study this property of lucency, which, by the way, was very surprising for me that it had not been researched. The PetriNet theory is extremely broad and extremely deep, but it seems that nobody has ever looked at the problem of lucency before, where in my view it is a very, let's say, natural property to issue. So if we see the set of enabled transitions, can we determine deterministically what the internal state is? That seems like a very obvious property. I started to think about this because of my, let's say, applications in the field of process mining. So process mining based on event logs, we are trying to discover the real process. So the process not that people say that is the process, but the process that is kind of reflected by just looking at the data. If we look at that, then we can see that lucency is a kind of natural property. I will give a pointer to a paper later, but there is also work on so-called translucent event logs. And these are event logs where we do not just see what has happened, but each time that something happens, we know what the other actions were that could have happened. So the same as if we look at the work list and we have, I don't know, 10 work items in our basket, then we know what are the 10 actions that we can do. And we pick one. And in a translucent event log, when we pick one work item, we in the logging, we can also see what were the other options. So this gives a bit of a practical motivation for the very theoretical concepts that I'm talking about. So lucency is in my view, a very relevant property. It was first investigated in my paper presented at PetriNet 2018. At first glance, it seems very natural to somehow link this to free choice nets. Because if we have these non-free choice constructs, like a long-term dependency in the process model, then by definition, the model cannot be loosened. It's also, if a net is unbounded, then by definition, we will have nets, and then it's very clear that that we will have multiple markings that will have different numbers of tokens, but that enable exactly the same set of transitions. And so you can formally prove that if the net is unbounded, by definition, it is not loosened. So it's natural to look at boundedness. It is natural to look at the free choice property. But as the example that I showed earlier, that there are even examples where Mark graphs are non-loosened. And Mark graphs are a subset of the set of free choice nets. The nets, this Mark graph that you see here at the top is well formed. And in the PetriNet's 2018 paper, I look at the situation where we focus on well-formed nets that are free choice and that satisfy a certain other property. Here we drop the well-formedness, and that is the surprising part of the result that we get. So the precise result can be formulated as follows. So if we have a marked proper free choice net having a home cluster. So proper just means that all the transitions have input and output places. Otherwise, we should have removed them before. They need to have a home cluster. So we have seen before what a cluster is. So if a cluster is a minimal set of places and transitions in such a way that if a place is included, then also all of its output transitions should be included. Vice versa, if a transition is included, all of its input places should be included. So that's a cluster. So any PetriNet can be partitioned in terms of its clusters. And a cluster is a home cluster if from any reachable marking, it is possible to reach a marking, just marking the places in the cluster. In other words, we are interested in finding clusters and reachable states where just the places in that cluster are marked, or all the places are empty, and we can go again and again and again to that same situation. So that's the basic idea. And this is a very, let's say, natural property for nets to hold. So for example, if you look at sound workflow nets, then the final marking always defines a home cluster. If we look at well-formed nets that have, let's say, one regeneration transition, so a transition that at some point in time can always be enabled again and again and again, in such a way that only its input places are marked, also in that situation we have a home cluster. So we can look both at well-formed and non-well-formed free choice nets having this property. So if it is proper, which is just a syntactical requirement, if it is free choice, which is a very natural property, and if it has a home cluster, which is also a very natural property, then by definition it is loosened. Let's now take a look at some examples. So here is a PetriNet, and I highlight the different clusters. Yeah, so for example, we have one cluster composed of just place P3 and P4. We have the cluster composed of P7, P8 and T8. So these are the clusters, and now we are interested, is there a home cluster? And a home cluster means that all the places in the cluster are marked and all the other places are empty, and we can go to that marking again and again and again. Well, if you look at this net, then for sure, I don't know, P3 is not a home cluster, because if there is a token here, there will also be tokens in other parts of the model. And the moment that we are in P7 and P8, we can also never go back to P3. There is one home cluster, and that's the home cluster that is here at the end. So it's always possible to reach the marking with token in P7 and P8. And once we are there, we can always go back to this marking because T8 is not really changing this. Note that if I would have removed, if I would have removed T8, then I would have had two home clusters. Then I would have two clusters and none of them would have been a home cluster. So in this example, this is a cluster. And because this is a home cluster, it is guaranteed using this result that the whole net is loosened. So this result is remarkable, and I'm repeating a bit myself, but that is the key point of this whole paper, is that it holds for nets that do not need to be well-formed, that do not need to be strongly connected, and the proofs are very direct. So we are not building on a thick layer of, let's say, free choice nets results that are very indirect because they are building on decades of research. These proofs are very direct and they show much better the essence of the problem. So let me walk through some definitions of the paper without trying to be complete or without being very precise. So we focus on free choice nets. We make sure that they are proper. We are interested in the notion of lucency. And here this is formally defined, that if we have two markings and two reachable markings, and these markings enable the same set of transitions, then these markings need to be exactly the same. So that's lucency. Here is the formal definition of a home cluster. So C is a home cluster if and only if we can always go back to a marking, just marking the places in that cluster. If such, so if a net has such a home cluster C, then we say it has a home cluster. And if there is a home cluster, it is proper and it is free choice, then it is implied that the net is also loosened. That's the key result. Checking whether there is a home cluster is something that can be solved in polynomial time. Okay, so let's take a look of at some of the intermediate results that are being used. So one of the things is that you can prove that if we have a marked proper free choice net with a home cluster, then it is never possible that you have tokens in the home cluster and also still tokens out of the home cluster. Because the point is you can never get rid of them anymore, and that has to do with the fact that we require the nets to be proper. So every transition has an input and output, so it is impossible to make a token simply disappeared without leaving any traces. Then here, a very important result, very important novel result, is the notion of a disentangled path or a rooted disentangled path. So a disentangled path is a path through the Petri net in such a way that every cluster is visited at most once. So it's not allowed that the same cluster is visited multiple times. It is rooted if the final place, so it's always a path leading from a place to another place, it is rooted if the final place points to a particular cluster. And then we say it's queue-rooted if it aims to go to a particular set of places, and typically we use this for looking that we reach a certain cluster. You can see that. So we look at a marked proper free choice net having a home cluster C, and now we look at the C-rooted disentangled path. So we look at the path that is ending, so Pn ends in the home cluster C. So we have a path through the network that is ending in the home cluster. Then it is guaranteed that on such a path there can be at most one token. And this result can obviously be used to show that the whole net is safe, and that there can never be places that have multiple tokens. But this is much more important. On a C-rooted disentangled path, at any point in time, there can be at most one token. How does one prove this lemma? That's actually quite straightforward. Suppose that there would be two tokens on such a path. Then let but just the tokens move towards the home cluster. These tokens can never disappear, and that leads to a contradiction that C is a home cluster. Then there is the very important notion of a conflict pair. So two markings in the context of a Petri net N comma M is a conflict pair if both markings are reachable. Both of them are not dead, so they are enabling at least one transition. The intersection of enabled transitions is empty, so the two markings do not enable the same transition. On the other hand, if a transition is enabled in one marking, for example M1, then M2 should mark at least one of the input places of if a transition is enabled in M1, then in M2 that transition should be partially marked. It cannot be fully marked because that would violate that no transition is enabled in both markings. But what this basically says that if a transition is enabled in one marking, it should be partially enabled in the other marking, but not fully enabled. Now one may think, okay, how is this related to lucency? It is related through this lemma that we see here at the bottom, because if N comma M has no conflict pairs, then the net is lucent. How to see that? Suppose that we would have two markings that would enable exactly the same set of transitions. But they disagree, because they are not the same. There should at least be places where there is a token in one marking and not in the other marking. The places where they disagree upon, we freeze them. We are not allowed to consume any tokens from them, but we are allowed to fire transitions where we just consume agreement tokens. So the rule of the game is that we just consume agreement tokens, we never consume disagreement tokens. And then we try to walk towards the home cluster. And this should of course be possible, because it's possible to always go back to the home cluster from any from an arbitrary marking. So we try to walk towards the home cluster. At some point in time, this is no longer possible. And the marking where we then block, because we have no new possibilities anymore, is exactly a conflict pair. This is a bit confusing when I say it, but if you think about it, it's actually quite quite easy. Then the result that I have explained before, they then lead to, let's say, the main theorem of the paper, theorem 5.15, which says that that there cannot be conflict pairs in a marked proper free choice net having a home cluster. So how does the proof work? And again, I'm not trying to explain it in all details, but we have a home cluster C that is indicated here. Now, suppose that we would have conflict pairs. And again, conflict pairs is what I explained here. So we have two markings, and these two markings are enabling transitions, but it cannot be that there is a transition enabled in both. But if a transition is enabled in one, it should be partially enabled in the other one. So here C1 and C2 correspond to such transitions which are enabled in one marking and are partially enabled in another marking. So C1 represents a cluster where the transitions are, let's say, fully enabled in marking M1, but are only partially enabled in marking M2. And we can see that when there is a black token, it is in both markings, M1 and M2. If there is this token with the 1 inside, it only exists in marking M1. It does not exist in marking M2. C2 is exactly the reverse. So that represents a cluster that is, let's say, completely enabled in marking M2, but is partially enabled in marking M1. So we know that we have such clusters. Moreover, we can make the following assumption. Let's first focus on cluster C1. We just pick any cluster that has these properties so that it is fully enabled in M1 and partially enabled in M2. We pick such a cluster, and that cluster is not enabled in M2, yeah, because it's only partially enabled. Then we know that the transition should fire that is, let's say, fully enabled in M2, but partially enabled in M1. Let that cluster be C2. And so we know that there is such a cluster, and we also know that C1 can only happen after C2 has somehow put a token into this place. Recall, the 1 means that there is only a token in marking M1. We are now looking at marking M2, so then this cluster is fully enabled and there should be a path putting a token in there. So that's the setup. If we would now assume that this dashed line here, extended with this dashed line here, is a rooted, so I should first say, of course, there exists a C-rooted disentangled path from this cluster onwards, right? Because there is such a path for any place, so it also exists for this cluster. For the reasoning that I indicated before, there should also be such a path between C1 and C2. So path starting here and ending in C2. And if we would now assume that the concatenation of these two paths would be a C-rooted disentangled path, we would immediately see a contradiction because, for example, if we would look at marking M1, then there is a token here on the path, and there is a token here on the path. So there are at least two tokens on a C-rooted disentangled path. And what we have seen earlier, that is impossible, right? Because then it's never possible to reach a home marking again. So this concatenation cannot be a C-rooted disentangled path. So if it's not a C-rooted disentangled path, that means that these things need to overlap somewhere. But now think again about the behavior that we described. So we have sketched a scenario where we start in marking M2 and a token is moving along this path to cluster C1. That is necessary to enable cluster M1. If this is overlapping with this one, then there was a point in time that there would actually have been a token here before cluster C1 fires. Now imagine that there is a cluster, that there is a token somewhere in the a C-rooted disentangled path from C1 to C2. If there is a token here somewhere in the middle, then again we have a C-rooted disentangled path with two tokens on it, namely one of the tokens here, that is there in both markings, and a token that is here, that was when we were walking from marking M2 where C2 was enabled, to enabling C1 from a marking reachable from M2. This all sounds very confusing. Please read the paper, but then you see exactly the construction that I just described. Because of the earlier result, this theorem implies that such a net, so a net that is proper free choice and has a home cluster, is loosened. Okay? And that is because of the connection that was in lemma 5.14. So that summarizes, let's say, the key result of the paper. Just to make a bit better the link to process mining and workflow modeling, etc., etc. Note that if we use process discovery techniques, they always generate models which look like workflow nets or something similar. And so the inductive miner always generates a free choice net having a home cluster. And so this is not exotic at all. And so here we look at the, let's say, BPMN-like visualization. This is the PetriNet visualization. And you can see that such a PetriNet actually matches the requirement that I just described. As I said, lucency is also related to the notion of translucency. So an event log is translucent if each time an event occurs, we do not only see the activity that occurred, but we can also see the set of activities that was enabled. So for example, if we look at event E15, was executed for case, let's say, process instance number 3. E was the activity that was executed for case 3 at this point in time. But we know that although E was executed, in principle also D could have happened. And now look again back at the practical example that I gave of a work list in a workflow management system, which visualizes what is possible, or a user interface which is showing to the user these are the actions that you can take. And then you realize that this is a reasonable assumption in some application domains. Note that many process mining tasks become much, much easier when we have event logs that do not only tell what has happened, but that also tell us what could have happened. If you are interested in translucency, there is this paper also in Fundamenta Informatica, which is describing this notion in a lot of detail and also provides a discovery technique for this. Okay, let's come to a conclusion. I've presented the paper accepted for Fundamenta Informatica. The paper shows that free choice nets with home clusters are loosened. In principle, this is not super surprising. it's consistent with earlier results. What is surprising is that this also holds even if the net is not well formed, is not strongly connected, etc. So this shows that the result is say much more general than what most people would expect in the first place. Another thing that is very remarkable is that it is possible to prove this result without using any of the standard free choice theory. It doesn't build upon a thick layer of pre-existing results. On the other hand, it is introducing completely new notions, such as the C-rooted disentangled path, which is by definition safe. There are several new ideas in these proofs that I feel can also be used to prove, let's say, many other PetriNet properties. Thank you very much.